killing. The plains of rural Norfolk are home to one of them. In 1999, Pingle House was the scene of an horrific double murder. Today, it is home to builder Patrick Withers and his wife, retired dog breeder Eileen.
Well, this is the bathroom. This is probably one of the only rooms that hasn't been revamped yet.
Except for painting.
There's parts. This is the original bath used by the murdered couple. Well, or the deceased, or whatever way you want to say.
Mind you, I
is the original sink, and this is the original toilet.
Soda.
Eileen had to cleanse it completely.
So I felt better. I felt, well, I can at least sit in it now. So.
It's strange to think that the people that were murdered here actually used to use it now, I suppose. I've never really thought about it, you know, until you actually asked.
This is all that's left of it.
Seems strange that the murderer might have washed himself and that one might have all gone to the
toilet.
He
probably did wash his hands in that sink. I don't know, but.
Wash his hands.
Never thought of it till you told me.
No.
I didn't. Well, anyway, I gave that a good bleaching as well and sodaing the lot.
More than 70 police officers are involved in the hunt for the killer of 89-year-old widow Connie Sheridan and her 45-year-old daughter Janice, well known locally for breeding whippets. They'd been repeatedly stabbed and were found in the lounge of their house at Upwell on Sunday lunchtime.
The Fenlands cottage where the Sheridans were murdered is so remote, no one would have heard their cries for help. 2 months after their brutal murder, there has been no arrest. The motive remains a mystery. Now, police have taken the unusual step of allowing the cameras inside the house in the hope of encouraging any witnesses to come forward.
There's evidence, as you can see everywhere, of the extensive forensic examination we've done. Everything has been pulled out. We've used extensive chemical treatments to try and enhance as much as we can from this scene.
That was the original back door that used to lead into the scullery kitchen, which we've converted into a bedroom now. This is where the bodies were discovered.
Well, so they say. One was there.
And one was laying on the sofa over in that corner, weren't they?
Well, no, I thought the sofa was here.
Well, wherever. No, it wouldn't have been there because that was where the door was. All the walls, they've all been redecorated now, but they had all blue dye down, spots of blood, they were circled with the blue dye all the way around the floor. The whole place was splattered in blood. It sort of cascaded down the walls, all over the walls, all the way around, wasn't it?
Yeah.
The old fireplace here had a couple of tiles missing because they had blood stains on.
How did these two women die?
Stabbed, as far as I know.
Quite a blood bath, wasn't it?
From what I heard, yeah, quite.
Quite forensic.
Quite horrendous, really, what he did.
It's deceiving now because the staircase used to run up that wall there, and this actually went right way back because there's a new staircase in here.
The bodies of Janice Sheridan and her daughter Connie were found 2 months ago at their remote home at Upwell on the Norfolk-Cambridgeshire border. This weekend, the murder inquiry moved to Crufts at Birmingham. Four detectives from Norfolk Police spoke to dog owners and breeders who may have known the Sheridans. It should have been Janice Sheridan at Crufts instead of the detectives, but the dog she had bred did her proud.
The younger one, she used to go to our dog training club at Magdalen, Village Hall, wasn't it?
Yeah.
I mean, you're going back, what, 4 or 5 years now? I was so horrified when it came on the telly, it was her. Couldn't believe it.
And then ended up living in the same house that she used to live in. It's a coincidence, really. Yeah.
I don't know what else you could call it.
It must be tens of thousands to one that 5 or 6 years ago, when Arlene used to go to a dog training club, meet a person, probably have a little chat, not too much, and then 6-7 years later, end up in their houses and then they're dead. It's incredible.
The Withers bought their house of horror with cash from the sale of a previous home.
Here.
Mrs. Withers was looking for a place to relax.
Sit down. Sit.
Mr. Withers, a place that could be done up and sold on for a profit.
'96. Tape recorded interview at Chelmsford Police Station.
What are you reading?
Blogs. Blogs 19. Story of the Essex Range Rover triple murders.
Oh, push me out. There's one door there. There'll be one door there, the corner post, and two doors here opening outwards. You could use one door, but two doors, it means you can still move furniture in and out whenever.
I reckon that the old lady was killed first. She was probably out in the kitchen doing something, the other one. Or she was out and she came in on it. I'm wondering if that happened and he had to kill her because she'd seen it. How can you kill two people at one time? Very hard, isn't it? While you're killing one, how could you be killing another one? I think one was being killed and the other one came in on it.
At the age of 32, salesman Kevin Cottrell thought he was flash, on target to make a fortune. But with four failed careers, the business loser couldn't cope with another rejection.
In June 1998, Kevin Cottrell, who was then working as a double glazing salesman, had an appointment at this house. The windows needed replacing, but Connie and Janice couldn't afford to have them all done at once. But by the time he left that day, he persuaded them to have this window replaced. Now, for the first time, he was linked to the scene.
The skill of Norfolk detectives and forensic scientists proved he was a double killer.
Were you one of many people who came to view the property?
There was a lot of time wasters. The fellow from the estate agents, I think he was a bit off. Not because of us, but because he had had so many people down really not interested in buying the place, but just wanting to have a look around where the murders happened. A bit ghoulish, really. So,
ghouls, he called them.
He was saying, "Oh, are you serious now?" I said, "Oh, yeah." I said, "Because I see the potential in the place and it can make me money."
Before we bought it, I was hoping and praying it wouldn't go through.
Yeah, I was, really. You know,
changed my mind, and because I didn't want it...
Because other people, more than anything, you'd be
surprised... Yeah, other people saying, or like even your family saying you're not buying that. Then you sit and think, don't you? Would you?
Would you? Are
Would
there
I?
Ghosts about or spirits about the people that actually got murdered? Did they? Because they were murdered.
And
did
people,
they,
when they approach you, they always say, "You haven't bought that house, have you?" As if it was a great, the bigger crime than the murder.
You know.
Honestly, that's how they, and they sort of back off you. This is the garden area. Whether or not the, I don't think the Sheridans used this, because this was cut off completely then. When we came here with a wire fence across here. That little plant there, that rose tree I got from Asda, 99 pence. That. This is the cesspit here, because they emptied that to find the knife. They didn't find it in there.
Who, the police?
Yeah, they had it emptied.
So the knife was never found?
No, people say it's never been found. The knife is still around. Could be anywhere.
Have you looked for it?
No. Could be in that tank there. That oil tank. That was there when we came here, so he could easily have put it in there. Nobody'd be any the wiser. I said that to Pat, it could be in there. It could be anywhere, couldn't it?
Over the last few years, East Anglia has proved fertile ground for property speculators. Prices of houses have risen sharply as people have moved to the area from the southeast or bought conversions as second homes. The Withers' purchase of Pingle House has proved to be a sound investment.
What did you pay for this house?
35.5, wasn't it? 35,000.
No, was it 35 or 33?
Around about 33, 35,000.
Yeah.
I forget the exact amount.
Which was cheap.
We've had an independent valuation as it stands now from Scottish Widows people, and he valued in excess of 100,000.
As it stands now?
As it is now.
That was without the picket fence around it.
That's right, you know, before that was done. If we sold it tomorrow, you could walk away with 90,000 cash in your pocket. So you're not, you're a lot better off than when you moved in.
Yeah, but I don't...
You know, being mercenary.
I think you'll get a lot more once it's completely redone.
It's the saying, isn't it? It's one person's misfortune is another person's gain, isn't it? Simple as that.
Well, it has in that case, isn't it?
I mean, we didn't really buy it to make a killing. I was surprised when the bloke came up and said that amount. I never think about the people that were murdered here. And it never crosses my mind.
Not now. We've been here 2 years now, haven't we?
Yeah, it did at first. It was always lurking in the back of your mind. Sometimes you look at the fireplace and you thought, well, she was lying there, you know. But now it's all changed inside. There's nothing anywhere except the bathroom to remind you of the people that lived in the house.
Pingle House is home sweet home to the Withers. Its dark history has helped them make a tidy profit. But for some owners of murder properties, profit comes at a price. There's the house with the garden in which a body was buried for over 2 years.
I can just show you what we suffer with the subsidence and the backfilling of the hull. I mean, you can see how long this stick is, and it just... You know, I mean, you can't do that. It's just because the ground's so soft. It just keeps sinking. It's done there, but you can see how soft the ground is. Just pushes straight in. I mean, that's what, 3 foot into the ground.
David Hampson is alleged to have bludgeoned his wife Claire to death during an argument on September the 26th, 1996. Police recovered a body from the garden of the couple's home during an operation yesterday. They later confirmed it was that of Mrs. Hampson.
The couple was having a domestic dispute in the, what was then the kitchen, and it went a bit too far. He snapped and hit her with a hammer.
Four years ago, Craig Vallance became the proud owner of a house of horror. He wanted an ordinary family home, but couldn't afford one. But then there was the house that nobody else wanted. The property that has turned Mr. Vallance, a dustman and former butcher, into a passionate gardener.
When you bought this house, what was it like? What condition was this front garden?
If you can imagine a jungle, that's pretty much what it was when we moved in. Hawthorn hedges along the front here, as high as the lamppost outside. There was a big conifer, 15, 20 foot high, in that front corner, and a holly bush over there. This was just a mass with roses. There was 19 rose bushes. That was with all the other plants and shrubs and bird tables.
Were there loads of people who helped you do it?
Oh, yeah, the most memorable one was the turf laying party. We invited everybody round for a barbecue stroke party, but there was no garden to have it in. There was just dirt, and there was a big pile of turf here, so we all got to laid all the turf and then had the party on it. It was different, to say the least. Nobody was expecting to have to do a bit of work before they got the free beer and food.
The court was told how 42-year-old David Hampson spun a web of lies and deceit, pretending his wife Claire was still alive. The former railway worker snapped after constant nagging and abuse from his wife. Hampson kept the murder weapon in the garage. He'd buried his wife in the garden because he wanted to have her near him. Carl Heidel, Anglia News, Northampton Crown Court.
The body was buried in this front garden?
Yeah, it was, yeah. Just over here. It's actually buried in there, where that light patch is on the grass, in that sort of area. I mean, it was... When we moved in, it was dug up from here through to here and sort of so wide, and it was just as though somebody had dug a hole and then backfilled it. All the subsoil from underneath was on the top, and that's basically how they left it. So... Just another bit of garden, as far as I'm concerned. It's just unfortunate that it keeps sinking. But nothing I can do. There's a hole in the ground and got to keep filling it in.
Why did you decide to buy this house?
For no other reason, really, than it was cheap. When I bought it, they valued it at 55, put it on the market at 45 because of what had gone on here, and then I bid 30 and bought it. But it had to be sold. It was via a solicitor because the gentleman who owned it was in prison.
Was there any worry on your part at all about the history of the house?
You mean ghosts? No, not at all. Poppycock.
Tell that to Mr. Valance's neighbours. Ever since the killing, his house has attracted unwelcome gossip, rumour and sightseers.
When we first moved in, there was actually people coming and parking outside just to have a look. Halloween was our busy time. There was one particularly elderly couple pulled up outside and got their flask out with two cups and started having a cup of tea each. Dad was reading the paper and Mum was rubbernecking down the driveway. It was amazing, really. But we had friends and they was bringing their children over here for the trick-or-treating. And you could see them pull up outside and push the kids down the drive, and the kids was like, "No, I don't want to go down there," and "Go on, go down there and knock on the door." And me and my wisdom thought it would be a good idea to hide around this side of the garage where it was dark. And as they knocked on the door, jump out on them with a scream mask on. Most of the kids thought it was highly amusing, but there's a lot of the parents that didn't think it was too much fun, and they sort of took the kids back in the car and went home. That was the end of that.
So what are you digging here for?
Turning this back garden into like a herb garden. Until we moved here, I'd never really done any gardening, apart from what I was forced to do when I lived at home with my parents. But since coming here, I sort of got into it. But
went on here before we moved here, we don't really think about our... Not that we've shut it out in any way, but we just don't think about it. But obviously other people do. But to first climb up the trees to cut the top off, and then it was a matter of getting a chainsaw to get through the stumps, kill the lawn, dig it over and make this herb garden. It's out.
Memories are in your mind. Pictures are on the wall. A brick can't hold a memory. It's an inanimate object. It can't hold a feeling. It can't hold any kind of anything. All it can hold is water. And there's nothing in a brick to hurt you. And at the end of the day, that's what a house is, bricks and mortar. It's unfortunate what went on here, but had I not bought this house for the price that I bought it for, I would maybe still be living in rented accommodation. I don't know. Who knows what would have gone on since then, but... Yeah, it's a foot on the property ladder. A good foot.
Craig's lucky. He knew the history of his house before he bought it. But because people selling their home don't have to declare its history unless asked, there are many people across the land living with blood under the carpet who just don't know.
There's a bright golden haze on the meadow. There's a bright golden haze on the meadow. The corn is as high as an elephant's eye, and it looks like it's climbing clear up to the sky. Oh, what a beautiful morning. Oh, what a beautiful day. I got a beautiful feeling, everything's going my way.
In 1995, Mr. Graham Blakely and his wife Glenys bought the lease of 181 and 183 Cross Street, Manchester. They run an Italian restaurant on the ground floor and live in the flat upstairs. Since moving in, the property and its distant past have been full of surprises.
Welcome to Geely's. This is the main restaurant area where everything happens. We do have quite a good bit of fun here. This is the engine room. This is the pizza from where your pizzas come from. And basically, the stove, and this is where we all perform. Follow me, Clive. I like Floyd. Just going upstairs to 183. Just going into what would have been a kitchen or bathroom. I think this was a sauna room, because there used to be televisions on a plinth in each of the rooms. There was a television table, so they had televisions up there. Now, you can't say they watched it in bed, because I don't think there's any beds in the health club, but again, it's had a checkered career, so all sorts are going on up here.
Did anyone before you moved in tell you the history of this house?
No contact whatsoever with anybody in that respect. No contact whatsoever, no information. Just rent it and that's it. This is the situation. Nobody told us anything, did they?
Yes, the lease.
It came as quite a shock, quite perfectly honest, when I found out. This is where we collapse at night, wife and I, after we've just done a hard day, which is every day. It's like 72 hours a week running a restaurant.
And have you decorated this room?
Oh, yeah. We've decorated right through. in brilliant white, and it'll just stay there forever until we chip it off and become vandals. Although, by the time we get to bed, there's no chance of being a vandal at all. My age, anyway. Finished. it's a typical daughter's bedroom. Welcome to the boudoir. I don't know how much you want to see, but we better not linger here too long. You might get frightened. This used to be a brothel on this floor. Okay. This was a bedroom here. There's an entrance there, an entrance here. Not a very big one. I mean, in here, when we came in, this is the dark room. There's just one light in there, and it's all painted black. But I think they made videos here as well.
What kind of videos?
Rude ones? There might have been a bathroom in this corner, but I mean, original bloody wallpaper. There's definitely somebody living up here. You wouldn't have thought so, would you? Really? Wouldn't have thought so, gentlemen. That's a strange pattern. That's very early. Can't believe it.
I've gone in for your paper, newspaper, milk, bread. Mm. And the lady was serving me and she said, oh, you've got the place where the murder happened, haven't you? We'd had to live down the fact that it had been a brothel and then to find out that a murder had been committed here as well.
So it's rather an eventful place.
It's like two nightmares.
Where in the house do you understand that she was murdered?
Well, we always thought it was in the bedroom where we are. I would like to know about the circumstances of her death.
On the night of the 5th of September 1968, 21-year-old Norman Bassett, in the front room on the first floor, killed his mother, Eileen. She was found in bed. She had been stabbed 18 times.
Do you think you should have been told?
Yeah, I do. I think it was very unfair of the agents not to tell us that. Perhaps they didn't know. It could be that it's been lost in time, really. If they had known, they should have told us.
You make me feel so young. You make me feel so spring is sprung. And even when I see you grin, you're such a happy individual. The moment that you speak, I wanna go play hide and seek. I wanna go and bounce the moon just like a toy balloon. Okay, girls, now come on, I've set the evening for you. You've got to enjoy it from here on in. So let's have your orders.
Okay. I think there's an air of bad luck here. There's always one setback after the other in occurring over the past 6 years. It's as though something is really trying to bite us all the time and pushing things in our way, obstacles that none of our making. They just seem to happen.
Since Graham and Glenys have opened their restaurant, business has been tough. Much needed support has come from family friend Yvonne Newcomb.
Well, good evening, ladies, and thank you very much for coming to Gili's for our clairvoyance evening. Normally like to start my evenings, if we may, by closing our eyes for a few moments and thinking of our loved ones up above, hoping they will come through to us this evening, and for anyone else that we may think needs a bit of a cheery hand or a bit of uplifting. And we ask this in thy name. I'm coming to this lady because I feel as if I'm drawn, as if I'm being pulled. I'm getting a broken ring situation. So you've either had a breakup of a relationship or you've lost a ring or broken a ring or...
I broke my nana's ring.
You broke your grandmother's ring and it's the grandmother up there. Grandmother in the spirit. Was it a diamond? Was it a diamond in the ring?
No, it was a cladder ring.
Right. Well, there's going to be a lot of movement again for you. I feel a lot of change, which is due for you. I do feel change around the home scene. Does that make sense?
Do you know how the lady died here?
I believe it was a murder, but I don't know anything about the injuries that she would have suffered. But I do feel I would have been, and sort of as if I've got scars here and here, as if there's a lot. And I feel my face, my cheekbones may have been, sort of damaged.
Strange things like feeling your clothing being tugged and pulled or tapping on you. And you turn around, there's nobody there, and I'm shouting, Graham, where are you? Yeah. What do you want?
I've been sat reading my paper in the morning, and there's been a, someone's just gone, hey, excuse me, silly things, and I felt a little tug on my shirt while I've been sat downstairs as well. I thought, I can't do with this. But you've got to get on with it. I do know that there's something wandering around here aimlessly and really creating a mischief, so...
When we've had the clairvoyant evenings, the grey, this lady floats from the stairs as if she's going back upstairs, and she comes and she goes back down as if she's going to the toilet, and then there she sits, rocking back and forth. I feel the empathy with the son wasn't as good as perhaps it should have been, and for that reason she hasn't left the earth. She wasn't ready to go, but she's still here. And people say to me, oh, I'm really cold, and I say, yes, I feel very cold in the toilets.
I suppose we could have a theme evening every Tuesday. We could have something like a pizza ghost. We could invent a pizza. Could do spook soup. Or, ghoul ash.
Someone's talking to me about your husband. Are they saying that he's really irritable because he's finished work? Can you understand why he's giving you that?
Yeah. Because I finished as well.
Right. And they're telling you you've got to do something to get out of that house, otherwise you'll each other. Yeah?
If you'd known the history of this place, would you have moved in?
It's difficult to answer.
We would have thought about it a lot. We would have thought about it.
Had we had the option?
I think we would have thought about it. Sometimes I think it's a pity we didn't know, because we might have taken a different tack in this world, and things might have been different. We might have been running around in a Porsche by now, but...
I feel a bit of a lightening of your soul around you as well. And your grandmother, is your grandmother in the spirit?
She is.
Grandmother in the spirit. She's coming through, catching hold of your elbows and lifting you up. She's telling you, don't let things get on top of you. Please carry on and push forward.
Would you live in this property?
Not likely. No, I wouldn't. No, I certainly wouldn't. No, I feel very uneasy upstairs. Maybe that's because of my sort of psychic feelings.
How it is with me, and you'll always be the only love I ever knew. I'll forget many things in my lifetime, but my darling, I won't forget you.
You can tell us what you think about this or any other programme on any TV channel by logging on to channel4.com/thinktv. A different side of Heather Mills' life comes to light in The Real Mrs. McCartney tomorrow at 10. Next tonight on 4, Tony's fighting temptation in The Sopranos.